Well, praise you, Lord. We thank you for another day and opportunity to come and share the good news, the hope that is in Christ Jesus with the people passing by today. So we thank you for joining and partnering with us in prayer, lifting up the name of Jesus, asking for his presence to move upon these people today with open hearts and open minds to hear the word and respond to it. Thank you, guys.
Believe on Jesus.
God bless you.
Believe on Jesus, my friends.
Praise God. Praise his holy name, San Clemente. Praise his holy name. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. For God has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness. Acts 17. God has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained and given proof to by raising him from the dead. His name is Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Praise his holy name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise his holy name. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever will believe in him shall have everlasting life. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Condemnation is not believing that Jesus is the Son of God. And then it says, light has come into the world, but men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. And they didn't want to bring their deeds to the light lest they be exposed or reproved. But those who are of God do their deeds in the light that they may be seen and that they're wrought in God. So we come out here to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ out of the scriptures. We're not preaching our own opinions. We're not preaching some cult. We're preaching that Jesus is the Son of God, and that is 2022 AD, and history speaks that Jesus, this is after the death of Jesus. Well, he rose from the grave. He conquered sin and death. There is no other name given. There is no other name given which men can be saved than that name, Jesus Christ. That makes him different than Muhammad. That makes him different than Buddha. That makes him different from Hare Krishna. That makes him different from every other man that's written a book. Jesus said when he was speaking what the Father told him. So we're speaking what Jesus said the Father told him to speak, and then his apostles that were given the Holy Spirit to give utterance of what was to come to pass in these very last days that we're seeing happening. And it says in Psalm 37 that the righteous man, his mouth speaketh judgment. So if you're trying to avoid judgment, and it says right there, you're not a righteous man. And Jesus is the most righteous. He laid down glory. He laid down being God in the heavens, and he manifested in the flesh, born of a virgin. We had a Jew go by saying, "No thanks, I'm Jewish." Well, Jesus is the Jewish Messiah. You don't have to flick us off. You can come talk to us. Jesus died for you, that you would have newness of life, my friend. Well, why would you push that away? Why would you flick off the preacher who's preaching how much God loves you, that he sent his only begotten Son to die for you? Nobody else has done that. Nobody else has done that. Laid down their life as a perfect sacrifice and then rose from the grave. In the Old Testament, the prophet spoke of Jesus many, 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 many times. Hundreds of prophecies pointing to Jesus being the Messiah, the Jewish Messiah. But it also says that he's going to come bring peace to all the world, to the Gentiles. That's why when you read Paul saying he was called in Acts 26 to open up their eyes from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to the power of God through Jesus Christ for the remission of sins to those who will be sanctified unto an inheritance, that they may have an inheritance to those who are sanctified by the blood of Jesus. You guys believing on Jesus? A lot of people walk by with hard hearts, stiff necks, and we pray, God have mercy and open up the eyes to the blind, open up the deaf ears, soften hearts. The Bible says, harden not your heart as in the day of provocation. So the word of God, it goes forth. It's powerful. It says it never returns void in Isaiah 55. And in Romans 10, it says, faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And how will they hear without a preacher? And how will they have a preacher unless one be sent? So Jesus sends, abortion is a sin, I agree with you. In Psalms 106:37, it says they sacrifice their babies to demons. And it says that they sacrifice the most innocent blood. So you're right, it is a sin. It's an abomination, and it gives the land over. It gives the land over to demons and demonic control. Read the book of Judges. When they forsook the right way, they gave the land over. They worshiped images. They worshiped false gods. And they gave the land over to, God bless you in Jesus' name. They gave the land over to evil kings and evil rulers. And then God would raise up a prophet. He would tear down the altars. And they would have a revival of sorts. And then the revival would end, and the land would be given over to wickedness again, and there would be more rulers. So it's a process, a spiritual process of God giving over the land to whatever the church is not doing. If the church is not impacting society with the word of God, if the church is not proclaiming the power of Jesus, that he resurrected on the third day, and that in his name there is power to heal, save, and deliver to the uttermost, to those who will believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. If the church would come out and be bold for the word of God, they would be able to say, Jesus is greater than addictions. Jesus is greater than gangs. Jesus is greater than divorce. Jesus is greater than whoever's harmed as a little one through a divorce. Jesus is greater than all of these things. You don't need the drugs. You don't need the wicked music. You need the name of Jesus. You need the name of Jesus and the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If you have that in your life, you are a new creation. You're a new creature in Christ. And that's what you have to be. Otherwise, you're a fake believer. And in the Old Testament, we see so many warnings of the false church. We see in Jeremiah chapter 6 and Jeremiah chapter 7, he was called to go out there and stand in front of the gates of the synagogue, which is the church of the Old Testament. Friend, believe in Jesus. Work for Jesus. The Bible says you're either working for God through Jesus Christ or you're working for the devil. There is no in between. Every other false religion is actually working for the devil. The only true one is following Jesus. Amen. That's what Jesus said. You're either gathering with him or you're scattering. Are you trying to gather to some other form of religion other than Jesus, like the Pope is? The Pope is trying to join all religions together. You see so many other false cults out there, Mormonism, many others that I could just keep on naming. Anything that denies that Jesus is the Son of God is an antichrist. You have the 12 steps. You have support groups that say you can have a God of your understanding. That is denying the power of Jesus right there. That's an antichrist. We're here to come tell you about Jesus Christ and he alone. He alone is worthy of our praise and adoration. He alone is worthy to come out here and stand on the streets and preach his name. There's no other name that's worthy to come out here. He is the name that changed me. He changed me from a hardened criminal, a drug user, a drug trafficker, a fake Christian who believed but was not born again of the Spirit of God and ruled by the Spirit of God. He changed me. God bless you. And that's what Jesus said. He said, blessed are those who are not offended by him and his words. Blessed are those who are not offended at him and his words, he said. He said, these same words that you deny are the same words that are going to judge you. So his words are powerful. Jesus had rebuke for, in Matthew 15, 8, for the religious leaders that changed the word of God into the doctrines and precepts of men. He said, these people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me, teaching what the doctrines of men. We're preaching Jesus, crucified and resurrected, the power of Jesus. We're not teaching a 12-step seminar, have your best life now. We're preaching Jesus, the only name that will save you, the only name that will rearrange and change you. And in the Old Testament, they were standing out in front of the false church, warning, lift up your voice like a trumpet, declare to these people the sins of Judah. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise his holy name. Now, somebody, I'm going to walk a dog, take care of somebody's dog. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise his holy name. He is glorious and he is mighty. So Jesus rebukes people that are changing his word in Matthew 15, 8. In another place, he said, these people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. They're teaching men's doctrines. and they're making the word of God void. And he says, these people worship me in vain. So just because you got your hands up in a church and are having a good feeling, and you might even feel some conviction, if your life isn't being changed and transformed from glory to glory, if you're not finding the calling on your life, if you're still going back to sin, the Bible warns that you're going to heap up for yourselves teachers who will preach to itching ears, having a form of godliness but denying the power therein. It says, from such turn away. Jesus said the road is narrow. He said, narrow is the way and straight is the gate in Matthew 7. And he said, broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many go therewith. And he warns about false prophets. He says, beware of false prophets who come to you as wolves in sheep's clothes. You will know them by their fruits. And so I'm going to help you understand what Jesus said by, you'll know them up by their fruits. Jesus says in another passage, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you're cursing a lot, if you're listening to wicked music and you're putting that in your vessel, then of course you're going to cuss. Of course you're going to have a form of godliness but deny the power therein. You're going to be the one that's still smoking, drinking, going to the bars, saying, oh, God is love. You might be the ones at the pride events. You might be the one saying abortion is okay. You might be the one saying sodomy is okay and God is love, but you have misunderstood the gospel that Jesus said, verily, verily, unless a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God in John 3:3. This is a spiritual work of God that he will do. He will do it upon you. It's not by the will of man. It's by the Spirit and water. The Spirit of God moves you to repentance. And that's why in Acts 17 it says God commands all men everywhere to repent. Yes, because he has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, Jesus Christ, whom he hath raised from the dead to prove to the whole world that is the name given that you must follow. Praise the Lord Jesus. And so to see the kingdom of God, now you've got the Spirit bearing witness. Now your eyes are opened that you were a rebel, that you were a sinner against God, that your sins piled up against you. One sin makes you a rebel against God and in need of Jesus Christ. That's why it says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Praise the Lord. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But if you're just a fair weather believer, you know, picture a wedding, because that's what it is we are married to Jesus. We are married to Jesus. It says that he bought us with his blood. We are bought by his blood. We are not our own, the Bible says. So consider that. Now consider a marriage where the husband or the wife is watching porn, flirting with other people. Their love is fake. Their love for their spouse is fake love. And that's why the Bible warns, do not be deceived. The unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Neither fornicator, idolater, adulterer, covetous, drunkard, reviler. Believe on Jesus. He died for you. Take this. God bless you in Jesus' name.
God bless you. He paid for you with his blood.
Jesus paid for you with his blood. It says all who are in Christ are new creations. So what we're supposed to be teaching in these churches that very few of them are teaching on is judgments. And one of the first judgments you need to understand is when you're baptized, you're putting the deeds of the flesh to death. You're now understanding what Jesus meant when he said, count the cost in Luke 14. Count the cost all the way to the end to be his disciple. Jesus preached like this. He said, if a man come after me and does not love his own family less than me. He actually uses the word hate, but in the Greek it means love less. Father, mother, son, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. You must deny yourself, pick up your cross and follow him. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise his holy name. Yes, Jesus said in another one, he said in Matthew 18, unless you be converted like a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. So that's another way of describing what being born again is like. God bless. It's like a little child. When you see the little children run by and look with awestruck eyes at what's the man preaching, that's what Jesus is saying, that innocence. Be converted like a little child. That's what it is. You need a heart of flesh. In the Old Testament, it says that when the newness comes, which they were prophesying of Jesus, he said he's going to give you a heart of flesh for a heart of stone. Praise the Lord. And so you got to be a new creation in Christ. You got to, the old life you had has to be put to death. Put the deeds of the body, mortify the deeds of the body, that you may live in the Spirit. And Romans 8, it says, now there is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ, who walk after the Spirit, not after the flesh. If we walk according to the flesh, we will die. But if we walk according to the Spirit, we will live. He's talking about eternal life. If we go on sinning, it says, is Jesus the minister of sin? God forbid. Those who are a slave of sin are a servant of sin. But those who are a slave of righteousness are a slave of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise His holy name, San Clemente. Jesus is more powerful than all the pills you could take. Jesus wants to give you the Holy Spirit. He wants to give you the power to overcome sin. People go to all kinds of other spirits in the world. They go to alcohol, which is called spirits. They go to drugs, which is called pharmakia. They go to anti-anxiety pills. They go to meth pills. They go to heroin pills. They go to antidepressant pills. They go to every other thing but proclaiming the name of Jesus. The Bible says that the mind that stays attuned to God stays in perfect peace. The Bible says He will give you the spirit of praise, to praise His name, and it'll cover up the spirit of heaviness. The problem is people are not proclaiming Jesus. They're scared. They're scared, so they go to the pharmakia. They go to anti-anxiety. They go to all these drugs, and they count on people to give you a sorcery shot to stay alive. They're in such fear. But the Bible says the fear of man is a snare in Proverbs. Jesus said, fear not man who can kill body, and that is it. I tell you who to fear. Fear God who can kill body and then throw soul into hell. This is who you should fear, says the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise His holy name. Praise His holy name. And so Jesus preached that when you are His, you're going to understand His kingdom. Another thing most of the churches aren't preaching is His kingdom and Satan's kingdom. Well, He told His followers in Matthew 13 that to you it's given to understand these parables, but to them it's not given. What that means is to the people who are not believers, who are not born again, they're not going to understand the deeper mysteries of Jesus that He gave us in His parables. Okay, and that's what I'm going to try to explain to you, to call back some of the backsliders, to call back the people that have seen a lot of falsehood in the church, that they will hear the Word of God, that Jesus shows you a picture of some believers who do not continue on. That's why it's not once saved, always saved. Jesus said in John 6, he's got people that are believers. He's got disciples that are following Him. And He says, you're following Me for the food that perisheth. So He did miracles. Our Lord Jesus cast out devils. He healed the sick. He made the blind see. He raised the dead. He did all these miracles. There's 40 that are written in the Gospels, and there's way more, says the Apostle John. But He did many miracles. And Jesus saw that some were following Him for the miracles in John 6. And so many that believed stopped following Jesus when He said that you have to eat of His flesh, which is food indeed, and drink of His blood, which is drink indeed. And they said, this is a hard saying. Who can hear it? Who can bear it? So they were the fair weather friends that maybe you've had that's backstabbed you. Maybe you've been hurt by a divorce. Maybe people have lied to you and abused you. Well, guess what? That's what happened to the prophets. And it happened to the penultimate amount, to Jesus Christ, who never sinned. So if you feel rejected by men, if you feel like you've been abused and beat up, well, welcome to the team. All the prophets were abused. Jesus was abused more than anyone, and He never sinned. It says He was marred beyond human recognition. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon Him. It says in Isaiah 53 that we are healed by His stripes, that He was marred beyond human recognition, that they esteemed Him not. You know, the world looked upon Him and esteemed Him not, it says. In Isaiah 7:14 that He would be born of a virgin. In Isaiah 40 verse 3 that there'd be one crying out in the wilderness. That's John the Baptist. In Micah 5:2, that He'd be born in Bethlehem. in Psalm 22 that they would cast lots for his clothes and not one bone would be broken. I've given you prophecies that go back for 1,000 years to 700 years and to 400 and 500 years that Jesus fulfills, and there's so many more. That's why we love to preach to the Jews who are still unbelievers. We love to preach to Islam that Jesus is God's son, and we give them the scriptures to prove prophecy. Praise God. But some will not endure. Some just want to hear the good stuff. You know, and that's what the false prophets were about. That we don't have to repent. The false prophets were all about we don't have to repent. And that we don't have to forsake this life and follow Jesus. That's what the false prophets, they would say smooth things in the Old Testament. It says in Jeremiah 23 that woe to the pastors who scatter my sheep. Woe to them. And Jeremiah 27, you see more about the false prophet than you see him called out. In Jeremiah 28, Hananiah said that we don't have to go into captivity of Babylon. We don't have to be judged by God. The real thing the false prophets wanted to avoid is the judgment of God. That's why it says the righteous man, his mouth speaketh of judgment. But the unrighteous man, he doesn't want to deal with judgment. That there is a day coming that the world will be judged by Christ Jesus. And Jesus said, woe to Chorazan and Bethsaida. If the wonderful works had been done there, they would have repented. And that Jesus did, so he was rebuking the people he did the miracles for that were still denying him. And he says, woe to Chorazan and Bethsaida. He says, their judgment is going to be less than yours. Do you know what that means? That means the more we know about Jesus, the more is required of us. We're in 2022 AD, where everybody has the internet. Everybody can research things for themselves, like Bible prophecy. But it's not an intellectual thing, I'm telling you. It is a spiritual transformation. It says, God will not despise a broken and contrite heart. He will not turn away. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who are meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are those who are peacekeepers, for these are the sons and daughters of God. Blessed are those with a pure heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled by God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for the name of Jesus, for so they persecuted the prophets that came before them. Great is your reward in heaven. Jesus just gave you the Sermon on the Mount, seven blessed bees. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount that he did not come to abolish the law and the prophets. He came to fulfill them. Everything that came before Jesus was a picture and a shadow of Jesus Christ coming. And Jesus said, you've heard it of old, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, if somebody hits your face, turn the other cheek. If somebody tries to take your coat, give them a tunic also. So what Jesus is saying is do not answer reviling for reviling. He says those who curse you, pray God would bless them. If your enemy's hungry, feed him. So Jesus flipped everything upside down that they did not understand, that the religious leaders could not understand. They were trying to live by the law, and they weren't even understanding the law, Jesus said. Jesus said you weren't even able to understand the law. You've changed the law and made the word of God void. In Mark, he says that. Okay, so Jesus comes and does everything perfectly, and he says, you've heard it of old, if do not commit adultery. But I tell you, if you even lust after another woman that's not your wife, you've already committed adultery in your heart. Jesus is telling us right there to live in the Spirit. We learn more about that as we continue to go. Take every thought captive, Paul says, to the obedience of Jesus Christ. You guys believers? You guys believers? Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise God, he died for you. The Lord Jesus died for you. People walk by like it's no big deal. The church is called an apostate church in the last days. Just like it was in the Old Testament. That's why God had to judge them and send Jeremiah out there to warn them, judgment's coming. Sending Ezekiel out there to warn them, judgment's coming. And did you know that the most righteous of the people back then were the ones who went into captivity of Babylon? Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And those were the true sons of God that God had to remove from the false teachers. You read the parable in Jeremiah about the two figs. Praise the name of Jesus. You guys following Jesus? Lift up his name. Lift up his name. Call upon him while he is near. Get yourself a phone and start listening to the Bible. He will take the sin and he will cast it away from you. Praise the Lord. Yeah, so I was a fake believer. I smoked, I drank, I sold drugs as a runaway kid, and I was a believer, but I was in my own bondage of things that happened to me when I was a child. I'd blame the Pope for being a pedophile. I'd blame everything else, but I was still an enemy of God, it says. And a man told me, one of my best friends who God used as a prophet, he said, "You're working for Satan." And it was the truest words I basically heard up to that point, and it penetrated me. And that's why we got that Bible verse, Acts 26:18, to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to the power of God. Praise the Lord. Because you're either working for God, proclaiming Jesus, or you're an enemy of the cross, and you're actually working for the devil, either through unbelief or through activity of rebellious sin that's against God. That's why the Bible lists the sins in 1 Corinthians so that we're not deceived. It says, be not deceived over and over. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11. Neither fornicator, idolater, adulterer, covetous, drunkard, reviler, extortioner. All of these lists, okay? Reviler is somebody who curses a lot. Extortioner, somebody who steals from people. Manipulates. Fraud is another way. Adultery is sleeping around with other women or men. Fornicating, same thing. Adulterer is breaking your vow between your husband and wife. People do that with porn. That's breaking the vow. Fornication is sex outside of marriage. That's why there's so many kids that are fatherless. That's why California has prisons, 36 prisons, and so many of them are from divorced families. Abortion, Planned Parenthood. California is a sanctuary city to kill children because sex outside of marriages produces that. The wicked music, even the speed metal, the rock music, Highway to Hell, all of this, the rap music, even the more subtle stuff like cowboy music, whatever the name of that is. What is it? Any music glorifying sex outside of marriage, getting drunk, drinking shots at the bar. This is exactly what says, be not deceived. This does not inherit the kingdom of God. Why would you be listening to that? You're still worldly. The Bible says, this is the message we have heard, that God is light and in him is no darkness. If we say we know him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus cleanses us of all unrighteousness, and we have fellowship one with another. 1 John continues to go on and say that if we do not do his commandments, we lie. Not the commandments of the Old Testament, the commandments of Jesus. Like I said, Jesus said, you have heard it of old, if do not commit adultery. So Jesus says, this is the command. Do not lust after another woman, or you've already committed adultery in your heart. That is the command. So all these false teachers telling you can watch a little porn and that this is okay, we need to pray more and watch less porn. What ridiculous rubbish I've heard from these churches. Jesus said, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. It'd be better to enter life with one eye than go into hellfire. Jesus preached on hell 42 times. He warned about that. Praise the Lord. Praise our God. For he is mighty to save. He is mighty to heal. He is mighty to deliver. Our Lord God, he is mighty. He is long-suffering, not willing that any would perish, but that all men would come to repentance. So repentance is turning from sin and turning to God and rolling your whole life into Jesus. It's not lukewarmness, which we'll get to. It's not going halfway. Jesus said, woe to those. He said, don't try to even start following me in Luke 14 until you've counted the cost. So we need to be preaching that. We need to be preaching that Jesus said, count the cost all the way to the end in Luke 14. He says, would a man build a tower halfway up and stop? No, he wouldn't. Would a military delegation send out a delegation halfway? God bless you guys in Jesus' name. May God's grace be upon you. Jesus is showing you, look, it's a spiritual war. He wants you to realize you got to count this cost all the way to the end to follow him. So a military delegation that would only send people, you know, and not count the cost, he's going to look like an idiot, is what Jesus is saying in Luke 14. Count the cost. It's a spiritual war, but I'm here to tell you, when you start doing the will of God, he gives you the Holy Spirit, and it becomes a joy. It becomes your life. You don't want to turn back. And you feel the power of God. In Acts 5:32, it says the Holy Spirit is given to those who obey. And consider in Acts, they were told not to preach Jesus. They were said, who are these unlearned people that are coming out here and causing a commotion? So these are street preachers. Who are these unlearned people causing a commotion? And they beat them and they put them in jail. And they said, praise God that we were found worthy to be beaten for that name, because they remembered what Jesus said about blessed are ye when you are reviled and beaten for his name, for so they did to the prophets. And so they lifted up their voice like a trumpet by the power of the Holy Spirit. And they said, who should we obey, God or man? Should we take a sorcery shot? Should we take the drugs that everybody's saying to take? Or should we obey God and say, Jesus is greater. Jesus is stronger. Praise God. Praise God. Yes, Jesus is stronger. Jesus is mighty to save. Yes, praise the Lord Jesus. Praise his holy name, San Clemente. Churches, come out of the building. Come out of the 12 steps. Come out of the building. And lift up your voice like a trumpet. Do not be ashamed of the words of Jesus. Jesus said, he that is ashamed of him and his words, he will be ashamed of when he comes in the glory of the holy angels. I can't tell you any more clearly, falling away church. It says right there in Matthew 7, Jesus said, beware of false prophets who come to you in wolves and sheep's clothes. You will know them by their fruits. Can a good tree produce bad fruit? No. And I showed you how out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaks. Believe on Jesus. Those who believe love the word of God preached, because it, you know what Jesus said? His word is spirit and everlasting life. The word goes forth and it never returns void. It says heaven and earth will pass away, but the words of Jesus will abide forever. These are the words of Jesus we're preaching. They're going to remain forever. Heaven and earth will pass away, but his words will remain forever. Praise the Lord. Praise God. And so a lot of churches are ashamed of even standing out here with the actual words of God. They're ashamed. And Jesus says, oh, woe to you who are ashamed of him and his words. For when he comes with the Son of Man, he will be ashamed of you. If you are ashamed of me and my words, he says, lift up your voice like a trumpet. Declare the word of God. Declare the power of Jesus. Declare that we're in the last days. Declare to the church that's falling away that the Bible warns, that Jesus warned about the falling away church. And I'm going to start giving you those warnings right now. In Matthew 13:21, Jesus said, some hear the word, but they do not endure tribulation and persecution. These are believers, just like in John 6, where they stop following. These are believers that will not endure tribulation and persecution. These are people in the church right now. Because I was one of them many, many years ago, 15, 20 years ago. I was the one that this very verse told me I wasn't right with God, that I wasn't a full believer. The next verse is still in a lot of these churches, Matthew 13:22. These are those who hear the word with joy, make it a little further, but the cares of the world, the cares on if I'm popular to you or not. If you think I'm a fool for Christ and you laugh at me, if I make that more important, amen? If I make that more important than doing the will of God, then I'm not going to produce any true fruit, because I'm going to change the testimony to fit what everybody wants to hear. But it also says the deceitfulness of riches choke it out. No fruit. Testing, 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 testing. So some hear, and do not produce fruit, says the word of God. Is it getting louder or quieter? Louder? Louder? How about now? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise Him.
if I were to go to hell, which I hope I never do, if I were to go to hell, my biggest task while I was there would want to come back and never to, and make it my biggest task not to go there. That would be my biggest thing in life, and if you have to know Jesus, that's the main case to not go there, to obey Jesus. Amen.
Praise the Lord Jesus. Testing, 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 testing. I don't even know how to use my own speaker. Praise God. Praise His holy name. So Jesus is talking about judgment 42 times, and He's giving us the parables about judgment, and He tells us that not everybody who hears the word will remain and produce fruit in Matthew 13. And the two types I told you that you can hear the word, make and believe it, but as soon as tribulation and persecution for the word, you become offended. Another version says fall away. The next hearer makes it further, the cares of the world, human popularity, the love of money. It says the deceitfulness of riches choke out the word, no fruit. John 15 says that if you abide in Jesus, you will bear much fruit. But apart from Jesus, you can bear no fruit. If you bear no fruit in your whole life, you're like a withering branch that's cut off and thrown in the fire. So Jesus said in John 8:31 that if you abide in my word, then you're my disciples indeed, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Praise the Lord. Praise God. So hear the word of the Lord and call upon Him while He is near. It says, let the wicked man forsake his ways and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Do not harden your heart to the word of God. Soften your heart that it may be able to save your soul. It says, soften your heart that the implanted word of God may save your soul. We pray that your heart is soft. We prayed that before I got here. You guys love Jesus? He died for you. Come here, come here. He died for you. You don't look happy. He's the Messiah of the Jews. You look unhappy. It didn't do anything for you to claim you're Jewish by flicking us off with a bunch of demons tattooed on you. May God have mercy on you. I'll tell you about all the prophecies Jesus fulfills. Micah 5:2, born in Bethlehem. Isaiah 40 verse 3, one crying out in the wilderness. Isaiah 7:14, he'd be born of a virgin. That's your Messiah. But you hate him. It says, let everybody who does not love the Lord Jesus be accursed. And you can see the curse on people. You can see the tattoos, all demonic tattoos, the flicking off of the finger, just the hate. And we pray, God have mercy. God have mercy. And see, this is an exact example why the church needs to be on fire for God. They need to see that there is a manifestation of who the true sons of God are and the children of the devil. And Jesus told us to go out and preach this. In Matthew 13, He says the children of the devil are the tares sown in. These can be false teachers, people that are thinking they're okay with God, that change the gospel to fit their drugs and fit their sin. This is saying that Jesus says in Matthew 13, 41 through 43, that He sends out His holy angels, God bless, to reap out of His kingdom all that offend and those who practice sin. So Jesus is sending out angels, it says. Praise God. So your angels are either camped above you, it says, and giving you area to preach. It says that the angel encamps above his servants and protects us, and that we have the Holy Spirit and we're not in fear of man. Or the angel will actually bind you and cast you out into outer darkness. This is how serious the gospel is, because God has appointed a day in which He will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom He hath ordained, Jesus Christ, by raising Him from the dead. Acts 17, he's proved it to the whole world. All the prophecies, we can give you more and more and more prophecies, but unless you're willing to repent and turn from wickedness, it's just intellectual stuff. We see a lot of that in the church where they still smoke and they still cuss and they have all the intellectual stuff, but they really don't understand these parables all the way. They try to get around it. They try to say, oh, you're trying to be justified by works. But guess what it says in Matthew 7? Many are going to say on that day, Lord, Lord, we prophesied, we cast out devils, we did many wonderful works. And to this group of people, Jesus says, you weren't doing the will of the Father, and you were practicing sin. Depart from me. And look at what he says after that. I will tell you the wise man, he who hears the word and does it. When the day comes where there's a lot of wind and storms and all this stuff that's going to come at the last days, the wise man is the one who built his house on the rock. And when that storm comes, it will stand. But the foolish man is the one who hears and does not do. When the storms come and the wind blew and the waves came, great was its fall because it was built on the sand. Praise the Lord Jesus. So you got to be a doer of the word, not a hearer only, deceiving your own self, says James. You show me faith and I'll show you works, the Bible says. If ye be without works, the body's dead. The body without the spirit's dead. So what that's saying is without the Spirit of God, you are still dead man walking. You got to have the Spirit of God in you. Without the Spirit of God in you, you got the spirit of the world in you. That's what it says in Ephesians 2. The prince of the power of the air, he's the power of the ruler of this world. And in the air, and the children of wrath are the children of disobedience. It doesn't get any clearer. You're either a child of obedience, a child of God through Jesus, by the baptism of Jesus, or you're still a child of wrath. Ephesians 2. You're still a child of the devil. Matthew 13. So these are the parables that Jesus is opening up our eyes to see that there's judgment coming. When I started to see this, I started saying, why is the church warning about these things? And that's the chastening of the Lord. It says that, do you despise the chastening of the Lord? The chastening of the Lord is clean. Praise the Lord. Yes. Yes, yes. Thank you, Lord, for chastisement. You know, the chastisement of our peace was set upon Jesus. Now we got to be chastised by the Spirit of God. It says in Hebrews 12, if ye be without chastening, you are not, you know, legitimate sons, but you are bastards, meaning you're not children of God. It says, if ye endure chastening, like all sons and daughters must endure, then you are children of God. But if you despise the chastening of the Lord. So do you see how you can be a believer, but not endure tribulation and persecution? You can be a believer that makes it further, but the cares of the world, the love of human popularity, the love of money can choke you out, no fruit. That's why God sends his word to chasten. He sends his word that never returns void. He says, preach the word. That's what Jesus said in Mark 16, 15. I send you out to preach to all creatures. And these signs shall follow believers. They will heal the sick, cast out devils, speak in new tongues. Praise God. So why would you go to a pharmakia person? Why would you go to a vain psychiatrist? You don't need to do your yoga and your Hinduism. You need the name of Jesus. You need the name of Jesus. All that other stuff is going to leave you high and dry. It's not going to get you into the kingdom of God. And it's just going to be like vanity chasing your tail around. That's why you see so much addiction. You see so much suicide. You see so much divorce and professing Christians. Not having any fear of God. Not having any fear of God. Trying to go everywhere else. To the women who have had many divorces. The woman at the well had five husbands. And the one she was with now wasn't her husband. And Jesus said that you've been drinking from the world's water, but you need to drink of the water of Jesus, and you will never thirst again. And she said, give me this water to thirst. I perceive you're a prophet. And she ended up realizing he was the Messiah. And she went and she proclaimed the name of Jesus all the way to martyrdom, to the city of Samaria. Praise God for his power. Praise God for his mercy. Praise God that you can have an abundant life in Jesus Christ. And Jesus gives more parables. In Matthew 13, he tells us about the end of the age, about the harvesting of the reaping angels. And it fits with Matthew 7. Whoever's causing offense, and leading the kids into sin and practicing sin are cut off and thrown into the fire. They're bound hand and foot by the angels of God. In Matthew 24, Jesus gives us more parables. Two servants, if one grows a wicked heart, an evil heart, and says, where is the promise of his coming? And beats his other servants with many stripes and is out with the drunkard. When Jesus returns, he cuts them off and appoints them with the hypocrites, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Yes, you can be a believer and get cut off at the judgment day. That's why it says many are going to think they're okay. Believe on Jesus. He died for you. So what's Christmas for? Wasn't he born in Bethlehem? Why don't you love Jesus more than your Christmas tree? Why don't you love Jesus? Stop teaching your kids about Santa. That's a lie. Teach them about Jesus Christ. I'll talk with you meekly and tell you about Jesus. So to all those people rebuking Christmas as pagan, I don't mind it at all. Yeah, praise God. Because that's what they want. They want Christmas trees, and they want to say everybody goes to heaven, but they deny the power of God. Jesus says you've overlooked the weightier matters of the law, judgment and mercy and faith. So judgment has to be preached. Praise the Lord. She could be a believer. I'd like to see if she's an actual believer. I doubt it, but she could be. Yeah. But see, that's an example right there of a servant that starts to get involved in the world more than about Jesus and his second coming, which we're going to get to. If you become more involved in worldly things and out with the drunken, Jesus says that you could be cut off and a portion thrown where the hypocrites are, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Matthew 25, more parables of 10 virgins. 5 are wise and 5 are foolish. The wise are ready for Jesus to return. The foolish are not. And when Jesus returns and they're not ready, they're saying, let us have some oil so that we can be ready for the master's return. And when Jesus returns, they're knocking on the door saying, let us in. And he says, I don't know you. He's showing you that you could be in the church and not doing the will of the Father, being caught up in the world, being more popular with the world than Jesus. Jesus said it's a narrow path. It's narrow. He says that he testifies to the world that the works of this world are evil, that you're not above him. If they called the master evil and called the master a demon, Beelzebub, they're going to do the same to you, it says in John 15. The same verse, the same chapter that says, if you bear no fruit, you're cut off. Is your fruit worldly? Is it more about the next concert? Is it more about Christmas than Jesus Christ? Is it more about your next rock concert? Is it more about your next cigarette? Is it more about your presence under the tree than the giver of all gifts, the Lord Jesus? If it is, you're worldly. The Bible says, love not the world, neither the things that are of the world. The love of the Father is not in the world, neither the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. These are not of the Father, but are of the world. Be ye separate from them, it says the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing. Yes, follow the Lord Jesus. Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus spoke on hell 42 times. Yes, we're preaching the words of Jesus, not JW, not Mormonism. Jesus is the Son of God, not Muhammad, who says that there is no Son of God. That's Antichrist. We're preaching Jesus Christ resurrected for eternal life. If you go on believing in him, you will have everlasting life, the Bible says. Don't be a hearer of the word only. Be a doer of the word. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise his holy name. You can see spiritual contamination on cults. They won't preach the word. They'll just hand out tracts that deny the power of Jesus. Praise God. Praise God, you guys. Praise his holy name. So there's parables that show that not all the church is ready. Just like in the Old Testament, all the church was not true. The parable of the two figs in Jeremiah. What do you see, Jeremiah? I see one fig that's rotten, and I see one fig that's ripe. He says the ones that's ripe are the ones that I had to judge and get away from the false teachers and put them in captivity. So there is a false church in the Old Testament, and Jesus is telling you there's a false church in the New Testament. If you have eyes to see and ears to hear what the Spirit saith unto the church, be on fire for the Word of God. Cry out. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So the parables are showing you a false church, five foolish virgins. They're not ready for the return of Jesus. The servant that grew an evil heart, that beat his fellow servants, that's out with the drunken, that gets cut off. That's showing you another thing that can happen to you. Matthew 25, he shows a parable of talents. One person that had the gift of God did nothing with it. And he's cut off. So it's saying, be a doer of the word. Everything I'm preaching to you is the words of Jesus. Be a doer of the word, not a hearer only, deceiving your own selves. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise his holy name. And then Paul preached the same thing. Paul preached that some will not endure sound doctrine in 2 Timothy 4. So remember, some will not endure tribulation and persecution for the word. The word is Jesus Christ, sound doctrine. 2 Timothy 4, some will not endure sound doctrine, but will heap up for themselves teachers who will preach to itching ears according to their own lust. So they'll want sin. They'll want their drugs. They'll want their false teaching. So they'll go to the churches. They'll go to the churches that will teach falsely, to never tell you to repent or perish, to never tell you that you got to live holy as Christ lived. 1 Peter 4 says, as Christ suffered in the flesh, so we should arm our own selves in our mind that we would suffer in the flesh, that we would cease from sin. He says, in times past, we suffered as did the unbelievers, with revelries, banquetings, partyings, drunken orgies, all of these things. We did these things, it says. But now, do not find it strange that you go through these fiery trials that all go through. And that those who still do those things look at you strange, it says. I can't believe I listened to a pastor preach this word but never even tell you about this. He tried to turn it into some meddling thing. And he's a pastor for abortion at times. So this verse is rebuking him that we used to suffer as murderers and evildoers and all of that. But now we suffer for the holiness of Christ, ceasing from sinning, putting our flesh to death, it says. And these are the scriptures that we're supposed to be heeding, not heaping up teachers who will say abortion every once in a while. No. No. The child is a pure living being. It says, before you were in the womb, in Jeremiah 1:5, I called you to be a prophet. So even before the womb, God had called Jeremiah to be a prophet. Who are we to kill what's in the womb because you had sex outside of marriage? Because you listened to the wicked music? It's not the baby's fault. So people will heap up for themselves teachers who will say, okay, abortion under certain circumstances, instead of saying, no, it's a blood sacrifice to demons in Psalm 106:37. Or for many other reasons, they will heap up teachers who will preach to them, let me have as many divorces as I want, when it says God hates divorce. What God joined together, let no man tear apart, it says. Praise his holy name. There is a judgment coming. There's a judgment coming. And it's been given to the Lord Jesus. And we pray that you would love to see his judgments, because it says, true and righteous are all your judgments, says the holy prophets and the saints and the angels in Revelation 15 through 19, over and over. True and righteous are all your judgments, O God, because you have judged the whore that made the world drink of her iniquity and fornication. Praise the Lord. His righteous judgments are perfect. The fear of God is clean, enduring forever. By the fear of the Lord, it makes men depart from iniquity. Praise God. I need the fear of God every day. I need to fear the Lord every day. I need to heed the word of the Lord every day. That's why Paul said, I crucify my flesh daily, lest I be cut off. After I'm done preaching, I have to crucify my flesh, lest I be cut off myself. 1 Corinthians 9. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise his holy name. So Paul warned about perilous times where men are going to be lovers of self, where evil impostors are going to wax worse and worse. He warned about the false church. Same thing we're preaching. It's all the way through the scriptures from the Old Testament all the way to Revelation. There is a church that comes in that's an impostor church. And he says perilous times will come. Men will be lovers of self, proud, boasters, arrogant, despisers of all that's good, covenant breakers, truce breakers, disobedient to parents, having a form of godliness, but deny the power therein. From such turn away. These are sensual people, it says. It says that they are like Jannes and Jambres, but their deeds will be made manifest to all, meaning you should be able to see it. That's what that's saying. These creep into women's houses that are laden with sins. These are ever learning, but not able to come to the knowledge of truth. Evil impostors growing from worse. Evil impostors getting worse and worse. And he says in that same chapter, but all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. All scripture is given by God, is good for reproof.
Well,
she said, I want to go have lunch with an old friend, and I want to be able to sit and enjoy my lunch.
Okay, you're so sweet and so mean. And so I'm going to try to be super sweet and mean.
Thank you.
Jesus said that not everybody's going into heaven. So wouldn't you want to go proclaim that people need to come into the kingdom of God? And Jesus said, do not be ashamed of him and his words. He said, do not be ashamed of his words.
But thank you.
Okay. You were nice and meek. I'm just trying to give you some words that you would hear him. I'm glad. There's people committing suicide every day. There's people that are going to hell every day without Jesus. So we're commanded to go out and preach. Not the sign of the cross, but may God bless you. May those words reach into your heart. He says, do not be ashamed of me and my words, or I will be ashamed of you when I come back with the angels. People are committing suicide every day. People are dying of drug overdose every day. People are false Christians every day that need to hear the word that can pull them back into the kingdom of God. Jesus sends us out to the highways and byways in Luke 14, compelling them to come in. Jesus sends us out to all creatures to preach his words to all creatures. Jesus didn't say there's going to come a time where there's just going to be one pastor and you guys are going to stay in a building and you're going to do 12 steps and you're going to join with the Pope and you're going to just sit here and change the word of God to take a sorcery shot and not worry about the people going to hell. There's going to come. He never said that. He said, go out and preach his words to the ends of the earth. And then he said, when the word is preached to the ends of the earth, then the end will come. And we're now in the internet age of the internet, where information passes to and fro and knowledge shall increase. People have now heard the word, but their hearts are hardened, and not all who are saying they're believers are born again of the Spirit of God. Having a form of godliness and denying the power therein, from such turn away. All scripture is given by God. It's all inspired by God, it says. That the man of God may be able to reason with people, it says. 2 Timothy 4, it says that Jesus is going to judge the quick and the dead, the living and the dead. You can come here and talk to us. You don't have to flick us off. People that flick us off, they seem hopeless. You know, we want to give you hope in Jesus. Jesus wants to give you a new heart. He wants to give you a new mouth. He wants you to speak for him. He doesn't want you to be depressed, have suicidal thoughts. We don't want you to be depressed and have suicidal thoughts. We want to let you know that you could have the suicidal thoughts cast out if you would believe on Jesus. You can have a new heart and a new spirit ransomed by the blood of Jesus. Yes. Yes, Jesus will take away your oppression, your depression, your anxiety. Jesus will give you a new heart, a new mind. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise his holy name. Paul warned that there are some, he said, just as Satan masquerades as an angel of light, so do his ministers, feigning righteousness. feigning righteousness. He says they act like they're ministers of Christ, but they're actually working for Satan. Feigning righteousness. Their ends will be according to their deeds. Praise the Lord Jesus. Jesus really judges our works in Revelation chapter 2 and 3, which most of these churches don't even look at. And it says, blessed are those who read the prophecy of this book, and those who hear it, and those who keep the things that are written therein. Revelation chapter 1. Remember the other seven blesseds? There are seven blesseds in Revelation. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb, for these are the true words of God. Blessed are those who die from henceforth, for their works do follow them. Praise the Lord. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their own lives unto death. Revelation 12:11. Revelation chapter 2, Jesus judging the churches on their works. Ephesus, street preachers, by the book of Acts, willing to street preach where the goddess of Diana was, willing to be killed for the name of Jesus, preaching Jesus like Stephen was in Acts chapter 6 and 7. These were street preachers, and he's judging even them, saying, I know your works, that you've labored for my name's sake, that you can't bear those who are evil, that you've tested those who claim they're apostles and found them to be liars. The reason we're out on the streets is there's a lot of false apostles in these churches. There's a lot of false teachers in these churches. So we preach the word that they may hear the word, that they might not be given over. Like 2 Peter 2 says, that they bring in false teachings, denying even the Lord that bought them, destructive heresies. 120 years.
That's a lot of years to preach.
Yes, yes. So the Bible's full of street preaching. It's only in these latter times that people stay in churches. I mean, California has tons of churches, but 200,000 people that are homeless, so much addiction. The church needs to bring their missionaries back to the mission field right here in their own backyard. Jesus said that these people worry about the outside of their cup while inwardly they're rotting. They care about how they look to men, but inwardly they're rotting. So Jesus says to the Ephesus church, repent and do the first works. I have not found your works unless I will move my candlestick. So Jesus is telling all the churches in Revelation 2 and 3, seven churches, to overcome to the end. Not once saved, always saved. He tells five of them what to repent of. Tells all of them to overcome. So false teachers that say we never have to repent after we're born again, they're flying in the face of what Jesus preached. The woman that said, I heard from way down the street, I can't even hear myself over all the noise. So praise the Lord Jesus. So the Ephesus church was street preachers. They grew a hard heart, it looks like. He said, your last works are not as good as your first. Repent and remember where thou art fallen. Praise God. And he says to those who overcome, I will grant you to eat the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. That's what we want for you. We want you to hear. We want to hear ourselves. Good and well done, faithful servant. Enter rest, says Jesus Christ. And to this church, they get the promise if they overcome. And this is street preachers that had to overcome. This is street preachers that were rebuked. Straight up. They forgot their first love. Remember where thou art fallen. And he will give them the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Genesis talks about the tree of life and the tree of good and evil. And what did Satan do as the snake? He said, God did not say you will die if you eat of this. He just doesn't want you to eat it to be as smart as him. Satan was already preaching against judgment from the very beginning. And there was a tree of life and there was a tree of good and evil, the knowledge of good and evil. And God said, do not eat from that tree. You can have everything else. But they disobeyed God. And what happened? Judgment. So anybody preaching against judgments is like that snake. Preaching the judgments is clean. It's how to show people how our Father has given all judgment to Jesus and how he's judging us. That's what I want to know as a disciple of Jesus. That's what I want to preach as his preacher. Praise the Lord. So the next church of Smyrna, the church that thought they were poor, Jesus said they're rich. We're in Laodicea. We're in the area where there's so much richness. And they say that if you're rich and you have tons of views, that you're favored by God. But God said, what is popular to man is an abomination to God. What is popular to man is an abomination to God. So the poor church is actually the rich church. And guess what happens to the poor persecuted church? They go into tribulation 10 days. The devil cast them in. So the devil ruling through the governors and through the beast system has them thrown into jail 10 days, just like the disciples were thrown into jail. When they said, who should we obey, God or man? Should we? And they lifted up their voice like a trumpet. That's what the Bible says. And so the poor church, they go into tribulation. The devil casts them into jail 10 days. Be faithful unto the death, and you will not taste the second death. No repentance, no rebuke, but be faithful unto the death. That's how the Lord Jesus is judging the first two churches. To he who overcomes will not taste the second death. Which you read the end of Revelation. If your name is not found in the Lamb's Book of Life, the devil, the false prophet, the beast, and Satan are cast in the lake of fire with those who are not found written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's why we're called to preach. Tell you about the judgments, tell you about the Word of God, that there can be peace upon your life. He can deliver you from the sin. He can deliver you from the addictions. He can deliver you from the double-mindedness, the drunkenness, all of that stuff that's not bringing you any peace. He will deliver you, and he will give you the peace of God. That's what we want for you. And when you have the peace of God, then you want to do the will of God. You want more of that peace. You want more of the Holy Spirit that's given to those who obey. Revelation chapter 2, the next church of Pergamos has the seed of Satan and the doctrine of Balaam. But he points to his faithful martyr Antipas. Praise the Lord Jesus. So what is the doctrine of Balaam that God has shown me is in the churches? And you should be able to see it if you're a child of God, if you're born again of the Spirit of God. You should be able to see the false church being exposed right now, and you should have a love for them that you would come out and street preach. You should have a love for the church to come out and street preach, to show what a born-again believer looks like, that he has a testimony, that he preaches the word unashamed of the gospel, and that maybe some will come back to the true word of God. Well, the doctrine of Balaam, it says in 2 Peter 2, is they forsook the right way, and they went the way of Balaam, the madness of the prophet. Numbers 22 shows you that Balaam, he spoke for God, but the Moabite king tempted him with the riches of the world and fame, and he sent a famous delegation, even more famous, to keep tempting him, and he became double-minded. And it says they forsook the right way, and they went the way of Balaam. These are those who are trying to build up mega churches who are joining with the Pope, with Islam, with all the world's religions in these last days. These are the ones taking photo shoots with the Pope. These are the ones falsely prophesying about Trump. These are the ones that don't repent of their false prophecies. It says in 1 Timothy 4, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, having their conscience seared as with a hot iron, speaking lies and hypocrisy. So when you see people claiming that they're hearing from God and they keep speaking stupid stuff, there's no other better way to put it than stuff that didn't come to pass about Trump, about COVID being gone, about God giving us a sorcery shot. This is ridiculousness that I've heard. This is not of God. This is of another spirit. And they have no shame in this. And they are speaking lies and hypocrisy. They're going the way of Balaam, the madness of the prophet. And Jesus warns about it through Peter in 2 Peter. He warns about it in Jude. And he warns about it in Revelation chapter 2. To the church of Pergamos, where the seed of Satan there and the doctrine of Balaam is. And then he points to his faithful martyr Antipas. So there was a faithful remnant right there who was dying for the Lord Jesus. They weren't doing the way of Balaam. And he says to those who overcome, I will give you hidden manna, and I will write on you a new name that no one knows but he himself, and I will give you a living stone. And then he says to the next church, Thyatira, and he shows all these good works, their charity, their last works are better than the first. But this I have, and this is a last day's teaching right here. that you suffer that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and lead kids into sexual sin and food sacrificed to idols. I gave her space to repent, and she repented not. To those who commit adultery with her, I will throw them into great tribulation. That's what shows you it's the last days. Jezebel in the Old Testament liked child sacrifice. She wanted to bring in worship of other gods, and she made Ahab apostate. And what had, God bless you, little ones. You guys have bright faces. Teach your kids about Jesus. See how bright the little kids are? They have such innocence. So Jezebel brings in every other religion. So that's how Jesus is judging the first four churches. You know what he says about Jezebel's doctrine, teachings? Knows the depths of Satan as they speak. Knows the dark arts. And she's in churches, teaching over men, falsely prophesying. She calls herself a prophetess. And so the true remnant that really hears from God, they're not very popular. Because what they're saying is repent or perish. What they're saying is that's wickedness. They're pointing to all the wickedness, the falsehood in the churches. And they're saying, come out from among them. Be separate, says the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing. And Jesus says to as many as has not this doctrine, I put on you no other burden. And he says to those who overcome, I will let you rule and reign over the nations, even as I overcame and broke everything to shivers, and I will give them the morning star. So you see repent, you see overcome, you see false teaching identified, all through Revelation 2.
I told his son not to take anything from those guys. It's a waste of time. Yeah. With the NASA shirt.
I know.
Wow.
I know. I see it.
You know what NASA means in Hebrew? Deceiver.
Yeah.
They put science above God. It says the fool says in his heart, there is no God. And they teach their kids that there is no God. That is such foolishness. And they think they're smart going to all these schools. Yet they're in fear, such fear that they had to put a mask on and take a sorcery shot. I didn't take one, and the Lord has kept me because I trust the Lord when I'm done with the work he has for me. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Why would you fear man? Why would you fear anything? And Jesus says in Revelation chapter 3 to the church of Sardis, you think you're alive, but thou art dead. This church thinks they're alive, but thou art dead. There's only a few walking in white. Strengthen the things that remain. I have not found your works perfect or complete in my God. Remember what's been handed down. To those who overcome, I will not blot out your name out of the book of life, but I will speak to the Father about you. Jesus says that those who are preaching his words, he speaks to the Father about. We see that in the Gospels. So this church stopped preaching the word. There was only a few walking in white. They thought they were alive. They might have had the big light shows in their churches. They might have been very worldly. And there were only a few walking in white. And Jesus says, if you overcome, I will not blot out your name of the book of life. Can your name be blotted out of the book of life? Brings up a question. Once saved, always saved. Says it can't, but the Bible says it can. Right there implies it can. Revelation 22, 18 through 19 says it can. Praise God. Praise God. God bless you. God bless you in Jesus' name. God bless you in Jesus' name. God bless you in Jesus' name. Revelation 22:18. If you add to the prophecies of this book, which a lot of people are doing, and the New Apostolic Reformation, and many parts of the big churches, they're changing the word of God that we do not have to suffer for Christ. They're saying that we're going to get a wealth transfer. They're saying all these crazy things about Trump. They're saying all these other crazy things. They're adding to the prophecies of the book. And God says he gives them the plagues, which are the judgments, to get them to let go of their falsehood. That's why we're out here street preaching, that people would let go of the falsehood. But the next verse says, if you subtract from the prophecies of this book, you will have your name taken out of the book of life. Yes, your name can be taken out. Yes, you can be cut off, just like I've already told you. Romans 11. 21 through 22 tells you that you can be cut off. Praise the Lord Jesus. We don't want that for ourselves. We don't want that for you. The Bible talks about being saved in three tenses. Our initial salvation, saved by faith through grace. and then we're sanctified, being saved unto an inheritance, and then we lay hold of eternal salvation, like Paul tells Timothy and all of us, lay hold of eternal salvation. Lay hold of it. Finish the fight of faith. I have finished the faith. I have finished in the faith. I have fought the good fight of faith. There is laid up for me in heaven a crown that is also laid up for all of you who are long for the glorious appearing of the Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord Jesus. So Sardis is a church that thought they were alive, but there was only a few walking in white. Well, what about the baby's choice? Come back here and talk to us. Rich girl in the BMW, come talk to us. What about the baby's choice? The baby should have a choice. It's a very innocent. It was your choice to sleep around and have sex outside of marriage and get drunk and create a body inside of you. Why is your sin going to kill that baby? That's a rich man's doctrine in Laodicea. So the next church of Philadelphia, Jesus describes himself, he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key that open and no man shuts and shuts and no man opens. I know your works, that you've labored, kept the patience, not denied my name, and have a little strength. Praise God. Yeah. Yes. Let me finish preaching, brother. Are you following Jesus? God bless.
Yeah, Jamie.
Praise the Lord. You following Jesus?
Bless in Jesus' name.
Yeah, you look good. You following Jesus? Praise God. Praise God. Yeah. Well, because a born-again Christian knows that that's the baby has its own choice. Psalm 106. We've been preaching about the false church. Do you know there's a false church in the parables? No, it's not. It's a biblical statement. It says the hands that shed innocent blood, God hates the hands that shed innocent blood. Psalm 106, 37. We're trying to preach the word to those who will hear and obey the word. Let me finish Revelation. I'm almost done. Praise the Lord. Well, hey, I'll talk to anybody. He says he's a missionary and he doesn't like that there's a sign with a baby saying it's my body. It's a biblical statement. It's a biblical statement. We do that too, but to come up here after surfing and pick one little thing while we're preaching. Christ comes back with flaming fire with the holy angels to judge those who didn't know God or obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. Bible sign right there, missionary. Missionary. Missionary, is God going to judge? Missionary, the mission field is right here in the United States. Missionary, come back. Come back to your streets. So the last church, Revelation chapter 3. Laodicea, I wish you were hot or cold, but because you're lukewarm, I will spit you out of my mouth. Because you say I'm rich and have need of nothing, but are poor, blind, naked, wretched, and miserable, I counsel thee to buy from me gold tried in the fire, that you may be clothed in white, that the shame of your nakedness be not exposed, that you may have eye salve to see. Behold, I chasten those I love. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. I stand at the door and knock. If anybody will open, I will come in and sup with him, and he with me. To those who overcome, I will grant to sit on my throne, even as I overcame and sat on my Father's throne. To he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. It's not a political statement. It's a biblical statement not to kill babies. It's not a political statement to say, be born again and know what is of the Spirit of God. Praise God. I pray that it blesses the hearers. I pray that those who mocked, God have mercy. I pray those who are still hardened in their sin, that God grants them repentance like he did me. Turn away from wickedness. Turn away from wicked music and your drugs. And turn to the Lord Jesus. I know I can't get it any louder. I'm done anyway. Praise God. Praise God, San Clemente.